Hi. One of the secrets to retention is engaging members. And hint, it's also a secret to getting more volunteers. Now, engaging members starts with onboarding, which creates a strong connection, a very human connection, your member to your organization. So let's explore how we can create onboarding that creates connections in making connections that last. Hi, I'm Peggy Hoffman, and let's talk onboarding. Hi. So we started this conversation around onboarding in our original webinar, Help Members Find Their Way, which you will find in your volunteer resource portal. There, we gave you the steps to building the onboarding program. Let's talk a little bit more about the connections part of that. And let's start with what research tells us is the catalyst for joining, and that is for connections and access. The great news is that in our constituent groups, we have both connections and access. We just have to put the pieces together for the members. We are the piece of the puzzle that helps members make those connections. So there are two steps actually in this process: a warm welcome and helping them connect into the group. In Show Them the Way, we talk about warming the welcome. Let's focus on this incredible network of connections that we can help members make. Now, it's going to begin with the conversation. In fact, we have to start with the conversation so we get to know who our members are. Now, I generally find that the best way to have that conversations that will be really useful to the member and to us is to think about power questions. And our power questions can really fall into about four different buckets. I find that the first power question is really getting to know them as an individual by asking things like, "So, how'd you decide to become a dental hygienist?" Maybe another version of this is, "What do you love about being a dental hygienist?" But it's getting into the human first. Now, obviously, you do want, and it's a great prompt question, is what prompted you to join. But I want you to really listen and help people kind of articulate this. So sometimes folks go, "Well, they're not really entirely sure." So listen for a prompt, things like, "Well, I need to learn more," or "I need additional education or particular certifications," or "I got questions about the practice," or "or I'm really just kind of looking to meet others," because that's how you can connect them to professional development. You can connect them to practice related information, tools and resources kinds of things, to other people or experts. The third bucket are power questions that kind of get at how are they thinking and seeing? Are they concerned about things related to dental hygiene? So maybe you ask a question like, "What topics are you interested in?" Or perhaps you say, "What career activities or what issues do you anticipate needing to address in your professional career within the next 2 years?" These help you sort of understand where they're going, where they're directed, and where some of their concerns lie, right? And finally, getting those personal questions of what are your hobbies? Those kinds of things can really open up doors to getting to know how people like to spend their extra time and how we can potentially plug them into things like micro volunteering, right? So, however you approach this conversation, have the conversation because it allows you to take their interests and match them to the points of interest in our own constituent groups. What am I talking about? Well, we generally offer three things. There's three points of interest in our groups. There's the resources that we have, everything from, say, our website to the ADHA online community to documents or effective practices, newsletters, social posts, activities. These are things they can do with us, everything from our educational programming, virtual and in person, to community service, to projects, even to the helping hand or volunteering. And the third area are really the people that make up our organization. And we can connect people. Usually, most of our organizations have educators, vendors, service providers, other dental hygienists, obviously, and in fact, and staff. So what we're trying to do by understanding in those conversations the interest is to be able then to specifically map them to our points of interest. Now, I generally recommend that you try to think in terms of connecting them with something on each of these destination points. So suggesting a resource that would be useful to them, as well as an activity, as well as an individual. We don't always know if someone's going to follow up on the resource, maybe not even the person, but they might get involved in the activity or any of those other variations. So help us be successful. Think in terms of the power of three. Okay, so we understand their interests and we have in our mind a way of connecting them to our locations. How do we make this happen? Well, that's where it's useful for us to have what I would call the tools for mapping these connections at our ready. There are actually three tools that I want to briefly talk about. The map of your organization, your value prop, the member profile, and the onboarding buddy program. So let's take a look at each one of these. The first thing I want to mention is the membership map. So this is really a visualization of your value proposition. Now, I'm emphasizing this notion of visual, and I'm emphasizing the notion of visual because it has more power than a list of benefits or features. So if you take a look at this example from a chapter-based organization in Arizona, not from the dental hygiene community, but it does offer us a powerful example of the value of visualization. There are three things that make this kind of more useful to members than our traditional list. One, graphics draw people in. We got lots of science to prove that, whether it's a graphic, a video, a photo, it draws people in before content. Two, it makes it infinitely easier to scan and land on something that resonates with you. I mean, just let your eye scan through this project. Whatever is important to you, you're going to zone in on a combination of the fact they have powerful, bold words and cool graphics. And three, it makes us easy to look at while being able to show that as you change, there's going to be a place for you in this organization. So this is an example from outside our world. Let's take a look at one that I found over on the Houston Association website here. What I really like about this is it's a kind of a cross between a list and a visual. But notice how I can easily scan through it. Notice how it's hitting the hot buttons for what we understand many dental hygienists connect with our organizations with. But it's engaging, it draws me in. So creating this visualization of your member map helps people see the larger you, but in a way that draws them in. Now, in addition to the map, and I want to make one note, by the way, if you're feeling like, well, how in the world do I do this? I'm going to suggest that there's a number of very accessible tools out there, like Canva, for example, Canva, C-A-N-V-A, and even has a nonprofit. It has a free version and it has a nonprofit discount version as well as a full functioning version, but it allows you to create images like this. So you have this member map. So another tool that is very valuable is the member profile. Now, this is really another channel for members to share what's important to them, but it's a very versatile tool. It's kind of the kind of tool that they can fill it in on their time. You can fill it in during an interview, but it gives you data. It gives you another view of your members, but it also collects it and puts it in a space where it's easier for you to recall and help people make those connections. So to make this work, it does start with asking powerful questions. And I've got an example here. I'm going to show you two powerful questions. But it also means I want you to go kind of beyond the typical, like, which of these reasons are reasons why you joined? Which of these values, things are you the most interested in? To what I would say interests and aspirations. Now think again, very simple. This could be a Google form. A Google form is, of course, a free access document, but then it drops it into an Excel spreadsheet, which makes it very manageable. Maybe you do SurveyMonkey. There's lots of different simple polling or survey options out there. So there's lots of ways of doing this that's pretty easy and simple. But I've also simply seen a couple of power questions put in an email that is sent from one member to another member, and they answer the questions. So different ways to do this. Let me give you an example. Now, the example I'm going to give you is actually someone who is using it really to drive the volunteer conversation. So you will see some questions that really focus on the volunteerism part. It can be adapted in a way that allows you to really bring members in. So I start with this first one, because this is a true power question. What is your, in this case, it's a laboratory science, science association, but what is your LAS passion? And notice how they have picked a variety here of things related to the actual content and also related to the activities around the content. So what makes this neat is you're finding out, if I'm going to connect with somebody and I'm going to put them in, I'm going to give them a resource, or I'm going to suggest a way that they can be a helping hand, AKA volunteer, it's really very useful for you to know what's going to get them to say yes. The second question, again, it borders a bit on volunteer, but let's look at this. What skills and expertise can you bring to a volunteer position? Notice it is not a list of committees. It's like, what do you like to do that we can tap into? And finally, what I kind of think, this is a complex question, perhaps. It's asking two things, and so you could parse it. But what I love about this is it's the interests, what interests you, and how much time can you commit? Now, again, this is focused towards the volunteer, but you could apply this to membership as well, simply by shifting around some of the answer options. So with the map, the visualization of your value proposition, and this opportunity to build a member profile, you now have two tools that help you help a member find their connection. Let's take it to a level that is really one-on-one and is really a connection, a connection itself. And that's the onboarding buddy program. So this is an idea that I actually saw in action and have since used, and it has amazing results. So the onboarding buddy program is built on the basis that you are going to take a new member and a veteran member, and you're going to make a connection with them early in the membership in a way that allows the new member to meet somebody who's been around, who's kind of in the know and has the ability to navigate some of the value parts of the value proposition. But it's also somebody who is committed to the organization. So you're letting their passion really be infused into this individual. So one of the best examples that I've seen actually comes from the Greater Philadelphia chapter of the Association of Fundraising Professionals. They started this program, and the way they run it is matches are made on a rolling basis as applications are received. They recommend that the match last just about 2 to 3 months, and that the connections or the schedule be based entirely upon the two individuals involved. So they're not putting a lot of rigor and a big checklist on this. They're simply saying, I'm going to meet the two of you, and this is your person, your go-to person for the first couple of months. Now, what they've actually found is that relationship often stays and it deepens. And sometimes they found some mentoring relationships. And sometimes the passion over here really engages this person to be pulled through and deeper into the organization in terms of volunteering. So in any case, you would click to apply the program in this particular case. And what's really cool is it's a new member buddy application. Now, one thing I want to highlight to you, do you see the two circles underneath the paragraph? It says existing member or new member. Now, what I kind of love about this is this openness to maybe you've got members who joined, say, with a discount and then never really got involved. And so you're trying to pull them back in again. The program is open to them as well, right? So it's, again, this application is very simple for them. What I really think is cool are the questions that they ask for the task force to be able to match folks. So notice how they say, so what are your areas of expertise? So in other words, if you're really involved in this particular case in direct mail, we're going to maybe put you with somebody else who is interested in direct mail. Maybe though you say in part of this application, you say, well, I really would like to be talked to somebody with direct mail. My expertise is in capital campaigns. It helps you kind of find two people that may have a shared interest. They could learn from each other, which deepens the relationship. But then they say, do you have any questions or concerns a task force should consider? So this is a real opportunity for you to say, for example, let's say you've got a busy parent, right? Who is also right now in this incredible space where they're, you know, homeschooling their kids, so to say, and as well as rushing to work to get the job done. And, you know, too many balls being juggled in the air, and says, you know, I'm going to have to work this around this. You could find another parent. And now they fully understand the constraints that they're under, and they can have sort of a commiseration as well. But then they ask, what do you hope to gain from joining? Now they allow this to be for people who are interested also in the organization. And then they talk about, you know, how much time do you have to commit? So this has been for this organization has been very successful. And here's the other little bonus that we need to consider is that the buddies, you know, those veteran members, it's a great micro volunteer opportunity. So you take some of your folks that maybe have gone all the way through the board and the chairs, past president or finished a couple of terms, and they don't want to be on another committee, but they've got the passion. This is a great way to engage them in your group without it being a huge lift, and allows them to naturally get to know people. So it's been very successful for them. It's been good for their first year retention. And as I mentioned, they're also using it to sort of introduce people. So maybe if you've got a couple of hot prospects, you might even go ahead and buddy them up with it. So these three tools help you create these connections. So the final question, I guess we kind of have to ask, is a very important question though. It's like, who's in charge of this? It's not going to happen if no one is in charge. So I'm going to make two suggestions here for us to consider. One is the board has to own it. The board has to say, this is important and we want to make sure that there's a commitment to it. And that commitment is that we're going to put somebody in charge. We're going to resource the position as it is needed. And we're going to make sure that the people that are making this happen get lots of accolades, rewards, and recognition so that it can be sustainable, right? And they're going to endorse it so they can help bring in the buddies, right? However, I'm going to suggest that this is a tailor-made project for a member welcome team or an ambassador team or a red carpet team, however you want to ask it, a group of people who really want to make your group more welcoming. Have them be folks that are committed to finding connections within the organization. So we got a couple of resources for this in your volunteer resource portal. There are some job descriptions you can take a look at. The point is, it's a great idea and it needs someone to own it. And as a board member, as a leader in your group, by putting this as a commitment and a priority, and then rewarding and acknowledging the great work of this team, you are going to deepen the connections member has, which will allow you to build your organization and build your volunteer muscle. All right. So it's always good that if we're going to look at some new concepts, that we have some straightaway actions. So let's talk about how you can act immediately. Begin with getting personal. So that means talking to members personally. What does he, she care about and want about professionally? Create this profile survey or some way to gather the intel to act on so you can remain with this personal connection. 3, put together that welcome team. Job number one is to help members make connections. Do not make this the team that has to also bring in new members or has to make lapsed member calls. Let this be truly the welcome team. Draw the map, capture the points of interest in your own organization. Help people see visually what you have to offer. Add personal emails and phone calls into the mix. Let's be person to person. It's something that we've been craving, particularly in a world that is so virtual right now. So let's pick up the phone. So connections at last happen because they're built on shared interests. They happen when it's two people having a conversation. Let's make this happen in your constituent group.